Hello, Betel of Britain.
Betel was founded in 1985. A handful of people were working in the streets and huge heroin problems in Spain. And over the last couple of decades, it has grown to include 1,300 men and women living in communities free of charge and in 50 different cities. And most remarkable is in almost all of those 50 cities, the centers are run by the men and women who first came in and off the streets. In 1996, we advanced into the United Kingdom, and we're now at 9 residences, running multiple businesses and caring for about 100 men and women.
I just want to ask you these few questions and then tell you a little bit more about Betel. But first of all, can you tell me a little bit about the problem that you're having? So you've been on heroin 10 years. Have you been to any rehabs before? Let me tell you a little bit more about Betel, okay, if you can just listen carefully. What we are is a Christian community.
Listening to you take that phone call just then, Mary Alice, mm-hmm. there's quite a long list that people need to know before they come to Betel. Mm-hmm. Do you accept anybody?
Well, we have to be careful not to take people in with severe mental illness problems or if they have court cases coming up. So we might need to speak to a solicitor or to a doctor and just be careful that we can handle, you know, the people that come in.
Right. And also listening to your conversation then, it seemed quite stringent. So, you know, do you actually put people off from coming? You know, once they hear that they can't smoke and there's, you know, all these kind of rules particularly, don't you think that puts them off from coming?
Well, when people are very desperate, it doesn't put them off at all. In fact, most of the people, it doesn't put them off at all. I mean, they're willing to do whatever because for a lot of people, we're the last resort. For others who are not that desperate, it might, which is fine.
Nathan, can you tell me what happens when new people come into the house?
Well, when new people come into the house, they're here for the first 2 weeks, and what they do is cooking and cleaning, just general things like that. Nothing too hard for the first 2 weeks because they're usually withdrawing from drugs.
Right.
So they don't do anything too strenuous, no.
Do you put them with somebody else, or are they just allowed to wander around and sort themselves out?
No, they're assigned to somebody, and somebody's always with them because they can do, well, they can more or less do everything. They're quite unpredictable, so we have to keep an eye on them. So they're assigned with somebody, and that person will look after them and take care of them.
Now, this Betel is a man's house, so how do men take to cooking, ironing and cleaning then?
They don't take to it too well. It's probably the first time that they've had to do it, and some of them don't like it, but most of them just get on with it because they know they need to do it.
Well, here we are standing in front of one of our workshops. We have a furniture workshop here, as well as in Derby and in Nottingham. And our businesses comprise just one of three components that really make up Betel. All of our businesses, which we'll discuss. But secondly, we run residential communities in each of those sites where we help stabilize chaotic lives. And thirdly, we really, the heartbeat of what we do is build church. We have a church in the city center of Birmingham, and we'd like to see churches grow wherever we plant Betel.
So these businesses, are they helping finance the work of Betel?
Well, they finance upwards of 80 to 90% of all of our activities because we're trying to teach men and women to help pay for their own recovery. Don't have to depend on the government or their families, but pay for their own recovery. Take that responsibility. So we're teaching them a work ethic, we're training them, and helping them break dependency from the dole.
You've mentioned that there are other centers in the UK. Can you tell me a little bit about Hope Farm and Manor Farm?
Well, Hope Farm is our property in the Derbyshire area. We hope to eventually house about 30 men there. It's our newest property, perhaps a few couples as well. It's set in a really idyllic farm setting, but near enough to the city where we can access business and commerce. It's the first property we've been able to buy. In Nottingham area, Manor Farm is to the north of the city, again, in the countryside, in a great setting where we house 20 men, a few couples, workshop, and a large storage building. So in all three settings, we're exactly where we'd like to be, ideally outside the city in the country, but close enough to get into the city.
Now, this shop is on the outskirts of a huge city, the city of Nottingham. What problems does Nottingham have?
Well, we know from the very beginning that there is a big problem with drug addicts and alcoholics, but lately, publicly, it has been much more clear on the TV that there is a big problem with nightclubs.
So So Jenny, what's your relationship like between the police, local authorities and other agencies?
Well, we have quite a good relationship. In fact, recently they were out to Manor Farm to visit us, and on an entirely another issue, it was all about a community-based initiative. But the policeman happened to mention that they hadn't been out for any violence to us, and before, our place had been run by other people that were running a rehab there too, and they'd been out quite a bit to them. So it was quite good, really.
Why do you think the police aren't coming out to you guys as much?
Well, I think it's just the grace of God upon us. Yeah, as soon as the men walk in, there's such a sense of peace. God's grace is there.
Life before Betel. Before I came to Betel, my life was literally, what can you say, it was a living hell. I started using drugs when I was 11. There was drugs always in the house. My dad was a burglar. Not just a burglar, he cut safes open, he was a criminal. There was always drugs around the house, there was always spliffs being rolled, there was always speed and cocaine being taken, so slowly I sort of drifted into it.
Before I came to Betel 2.5 years ago, my life was a complete mess. I had no hope, no future, no life, no desires. I didn't have anything. I was a heroin addict and I was living on the streets, working on the streets, doing what heroin addicts do to make money. When I was 11, I started drinking, smoking cigarettes, taking amphetamines, taking LSD, and getting addicted to drugs. I took anything that would just take me away.
And as you take cocaine and smoke, you know, as you smoke dope, one thing leads to another. By the time I was 14, I was taking coke. I'd tried heroin, I'd tried acid. I'd tried all kinds of things. I used to take my mum's sleeping tablets. By the time I was 16, 17, I'd spent my first stints inside juvenile detention halls. Ended up, I wouldn't be a good boy in prison, so they ended up sending me down to Dartmoor, which is down by Plymouth on the moors. And I spent most of the majority of my sentence there. I got out of there in 1998. Still had a heroin habit. I'd been taking heroin the complete sentence. So I got out of there looking rather worse than when I went in. Came out, and because I didn't know any better, I went straight back to Leeds, and it was straight back into the same old thing.
Lost everything. My family didn't want to know me. I was a wreck. And then I found out about a place called Betel. I rang up and I came for 14 months, and whilst I was here I found a place where people loved me for who I was, even though I found it hard, and I left.
I was picked up at the bus station by Veronica and a couple of other guys, and I came, and I was in a state. I weighed 9 stone 6 or 9 stone 10, I had long hair, I was in a complete mess. There was lots of guys around, all working on the grounds. Back then, Betel was very small in England. There was only like 14 guys here. And they'd just come back from Grapevine, so all these guys were all really on fire telling me about Jesus and telling me about that. But I was completely out of my mind, and I actually thought they were in a bit of a worse state than I was, you know. I was delirious, but they were completely demented. And they began anyway. They loved the show me when I came. I knew there was something there. They had something that I wanted.
And then things went pear-shaped again. I met up with an old friend and started to take heroin, and ended up doing the things I did before, but worse, in a short space of time. And then I just couldn't do it because I knew that wasn't what my life was for. God must have touched my life to let me know that. So I found myself back at Betel, and I've been back 2.5 years.
But here probably was the worst cold turkey I've ever been through in my entire life. I spent 2 weeks awake. 2 weeks of watching the sun go up. I always describe it, watching the sun go up and watching the sun go down. Every single part of my body was hurting. And all the guys used to take it in a rota, because there weren't that many guys, and they'd take it in a rota and they'd sit up an hour every night. And they'd sit and they'd tell me about Jesus, you know, they'd tell me about how Jesus had been changing their lives. And at first I didn't really take any notice of them. I was just there, I was in pain, I was bothered about what I was going through and not about what they were saying. I appreciated the fact that they were there, that every time I was sick on the floor they cleaned it up. You know, that when I wanted a cup of tea they'd go and do it for me. You know, that when I couldn't get to the toilet because my legs wouldn't work properly, they'd help me get there. I appreciated all that, but the Jesus thing, I just because I wasn't in a right state of mind at the time. And I prayed the first time, you know, Lord, if you're there, if you're real, Jesus, and you've actually changed these guys, then you need to change me, because I can't change myself. I've tried and it don't work. And I really need some sleep, by the way. And that night I slept living room floor for the first time.
And it's great because I've got friends who love me. I've got a house full of people that care and real friends. I never knew what real friends were till I came to Betel. And the Lord's changed my life and he's given me so much, and I've discovered so much I can do. Now I'm responsible for things. Before I couldn't be trusted with £10, and now I can be trusted to run a shop, be a leader of a girl's house and take care of other girls that are coming off drugs and hopefully show them what a good life is like because of Jesus.
And life now is great. 5.5 years down the line, I've been married for nearly 3 years. I have two lovely sons. Raphael's 10, Aaron's 11 months old. My wife Paula, she's a beautiful woman from Portugal. She came to start the girls' house, and that's how we met. The Lord brought us together. And now, life now is Betel and Jesus.
Betel does is focus on restoration of the whole personality through the gospel. 80-90% of the men and women that we help come from fractured families. Most have never had a stable father figure. And while what we do would be considered generally rehabilitation, that conjures up a lot of conventional meaning. We don't use the word rehab a lot. We tell people that we're reparenting young men and women, helping restore a sense of extended family and wholeness to their lives by the gospel.
Reading some of the statistics here about the UK, drugs being responsible for even the crime rate and also the breakup of families, do you think the situation is getting better or worse?
Clearly it's getting worse. At the sharp end where we are, we have a steady flow of calls from people. The majority of men and women who come to us come from very splintered backgrounds. And statistics now say that the UK is the largest importer in the West per capita of heroin. So the problems associated with it are just going to continue to grow.
What about cannabis, since it's sort of been decriminalized? Do you think there's confusion now about that drug?
Great confusion. What signal are we sending to a younger generation? We believe illegal drugs should be kept illegal. And we turn the whole issue of cannabis on its head. Rather than being the safer, softer drug being sold to a younger generation, we say perhaps it's the worst of the drugs. It's a gateway drug. It may not cause the immediate serious harm that something like heroin does, but what it does, it becomes the gateway to lead children and lead a younger generation further into the drug problem, and then it separates you from the people who love you most immediately, from teachers, from parents, and that opens the gate wider.
Mary Alice, why do you do this?
Well, Kent and I have both felt since we were teenagers, when we first got saved, that we were to work with the desperately needy. And really, in this day and age, the most desperate are the youth that are just enslaved in drugs. And so the Lord's called us to this generation.
You say God's called you, so where have you come from?
Well, we've come from the States, and then to Spain, first of all, to learn about Betel, to learn where the center was, where it began, and learned on the job how to deal with drug addiction, and just learned the culture of Betel, and then came here about 8 years ago.
Do you ever feel sometimes like giving up? It seems a very tough kind of calling.
Right. I would say in the beginning, especially coming here when you're pioneering a work, it was a lot harder because we didn't see a lot of fruit to our labor. But now, after 8 years, and we see wonderful fruit, I don't get discouraged very often. And if I do, I just look at the fruit. And we feel very blessed, and we're here for as long as God calls us here, which we believe is forever.
Tell me about some of your outreaches you'll do.
Well, we have a program for children ages 7 to 11, a kids club.
We have a program called Catalyst for youth, and then we do community banquets. Should invite people in and just have an act of kindness just to bless them, bless the community. And we've had the first banquet for 400, and exactly 400 people showed up. This banquet's about 500 people. This is the third one, like I said. And we're just filling the room with God's presence and God's pleasure and blessing people. It's really what we're doing, serving people a meal, serving dessert, serving tea and coffee, and just loving people, getting to know the community. It's just people from the streets, and we go around door to door with invitations and ask people if they'd like to come, absolutely free, and just visit with their neighbors and have a nice meal together.
Can't go back, I'm never gonna go back. I'm ready for life, cut it, no slack. It's as my thoughts come to a halt. If I look back, I'll turn to a pillar of salt. So I can't go back, can't look back. Cause next thing I know, I'll be sliding back.
Can't go back.
Kent, what's your vision for the future of Betel UK?
Well, our vision is to grow. The problem is growing at an alarming rate. There are very few resources available to people. We want to grow up throughout the nation and really follow the pattern set for us by Elliot Mary Tupper and Lindsay Mike McKenzie, whose faith stimulated the growth of Betel from Madrid into multiple countries around the world. We want to reach the UK in the same manner. We want to reach one city every year for the next 10 years. We want to send workers to expansion sites where Betel is reaching into South Africa, into Bulgaria, into Australia and other nations. But to facilitate all this and expanding vision, we need help. We are earning up to 80 to 90% of our operating expenses. Men and women who've been dependent all their lives on the dole, working hard to pay for their own recovery. But we need help with that remaining 10, 20% from churches. We need it for capital expenses, vehicles, and properties around the country. We need them paid for and given to us. And we need sacrificial, exemplary Christian workers who want to come and live with the men and women and serve among them. And so we need that help. And by God's grace, with that help, the vision will grow and expand. It wasn't born.